Hello friends, in the previous lecture we have discussed first come first serve CPU scheduling algorithm and what is job first CPU scheduling algorithm, preemptive and non-preemptive. In this session we are going to discuss another set of CPU scheduling algorithm, including priority based CPU scheduling algorithm, round robin CPU scheduling algorithm, multi-level feedback, multi-level queue and multiprocessor CPU scheduling algorithm. Let us start the priority scheduling algorithm. So in the priority scheduling algorithm, priority is associated with the each processor, each process, and the CPU is allocated to process with the highest priority. But in the case of equal priority processes, they are scheduled in the first come first serve order. Generally, priority are the fixed number that are given to every process. There is no fixed agreement whether the highest number will be considered as the lowest priority or lowest priority will be considered as the highest priority. In some system, the lowest number is assumed to be the highest priority. And the CPU is allocated to the process with the highest priority. We will consider the smallest integer as the highest priority in our example. Let us take an example. Consider we have some set of processes and they are arrived at the zero time, and the order P1, P2 up to P5, and the associated CPU burst time is given in milliseconds. There are processes P1, P2, P3 and P4 and P5, and the priority that given with this set of processes, say P1 has the priority 3 and P2 has the priority 1 and so on. And in this example we are considering that the priority of the process with the lowest number has the highest priority. In this case, the P2 as the process is the highest priority 1. We will calculate the turnaround time and waiting time. In this case, because the priority of P2 is the highest, so the processor will be given to the process P2. So in this case, the waiting time of P2 is 0, and at a 0 millisecond time it will start the execution, and the total burst time of T2 is 1. So turnaround time can be calculated as the burst time of that process plus the waiting time. So the turnaround time of T2 is 1 millisecond. After that, as soon as P2 finishes the execution, P5 will get the CPU because the priority of P5 is 2. So in 1 millisecond CPU time, the P2 will finish the execution. This is the waiting time of P5. So the turnaround time of P5 can be calculated as the burst time of P5 plus the waiting time of P5. So the waiting time of P5 is 1 millisecond. And the turnaround time of P5 is 5 plus 1 is 6 milliseconds. Now, at this point, P1 and P3 having the same priority. So, whenever there is a tie between two processes having the same priority, we will consider FCFS algorithm to break this tie. In this case, P1 entered the system first, so P1 will be served first compared to P3. So the waiting time of P1 is the turnaround time of previous process. In this case, previous process is P5. So waiting time of P1 is 6 millisecond, and turnaround time is equal to waiting time of P1 plus the burst time of P1, that is 16 milliseconds. Similarly, we will schedule P3 and later we will schedule P4. If we make the Gantt chart of this arrangement, can easily simulate, like at 0 millisecond time P2 starts, and the bus time of P2 is 1 millisecond. So it will finish at the first 1 millisecond, then P5 will start the execution, start at 1 millisecond, and because the bus time of P5 is 5 milliseconds, so it will finish at 6 milliseconds, and so on. The average turnaround time can be calculated as the turnaround time of P1 plus turnaround time of P2 plus turnaround time of P3 divided by and so on divided by the number of processes, that's 5. So then we will get the average turnaround time is 12 milliseconds. Similarly, we can calculate the average waiting time and we will get 8.2 milliseconds. There are two types of priority based efficiency algorithm. One is preemptive, another one is non-preemptive. So when a process arrives at the ready queue, its priority is compared with the priority of the currently running process. In case of preemptive priority efficiency algorithm, the process is preempted if the priority of the newly arrived process is higher than the priority of currently running process. But in case of non-preemptive priority shifting algorithm, it will simply put the new process in a ready queue. While using the priority based CPU shifting algorithm, there is a problem of starvation. So what is the starvation problem? As soon as the highest priority process enters the system, the lowest priority process will be preempted and the CPU is given to the process with the highest priority. In this case, the lowest priority process may never execute, because as soon as the new process is coming, we are comparing the priority of that process and we are preempting if the priority is higher than the currently running process. So to overcome this problem, we have a solution, and the solution is aging. So what is aging? In that aging, as the time progresses, we increase the priority of the process that is not getting the CPU for the longer span of time. It's a technique of gradually increasing the priority of process that wait in the system for the long time. For example, for a certain amount of time, if the process is not getting the CPU, we will increase the priority by some number, and we assume that after a certain amount of time, it will get the CPU. The next algorithm is round robin CPU shifting algorithm. It is specially designed for the time sharing system. It is very much similar to the first come first serve CPU shifting algorithm, but preemption is added to switch between the process. We know that FCFS is a non-preemptive CPU shifting algorithm. So what we do in round robin CPU shifting algorithm, a small unit of time that is called time quantum or time slice is defined. A time quantum is generally from 10 to 100 milliseconds. The ready queue is treated as a circular queue, and the CPU scheduler goes around the ready queue allocating the CPU to each process for a time interval of up to the time quantum. After this time quantum, if the time quantum expires, the process is preempted and added to the end of the ready queue. In this way, we are scheduling all the processes in the ready queue. It means a process is given only a single time quantum, and whenever a time quantum expires, the process is preempted and the CPU is given to the next process. In the case of round robin CPU shifting algorithm, there are two possibilities during the execution of the CPU. The first possibility is if the process CPU burst time is less than one time quantum. So in this case, the process itself will release the CPU and the scheduler will then proceed the next process in the ready queue. But there may be a situation when the CPU burst time of current running process is longer than the one time quantum. In this case, the preemption must be performed. So, what are the various steps will be performed by the OS? First of all, the time whenever time will go off, it will cause the interrupt to the operating system. The operating system will issue the system command for performing the context switch, and the process will be put in the tail of the ready queue. The CPU scheduler will then select the next process in the ready queue. For analyzing the round robin CPU scheduling algorithm, if there are n processes in the ready queue and the time quantum is few milliseconds, then the each process gets 1 by n of CPU time in chunks of at most few time unit at once. So no process get more than n minus 1 few time units. In case of round robin CPU scheduling algorithm, the average waiting time is often very long. The performance of the round robin CPU scheduling algorithm can be measured by examining the length of the time quantum. If you choose the time quantum very large, it will be considered as a FIFO. And if we choose it is very small compared to context switching time, we will have more context switching time because the burst time is very larger than the one time quantum, and we will have many context switches to execute any process. So the queue must be large with respect to the context switch, otherwise the overhead is too high. Consider the following example. In this example, we are assuming that all the processes arriving at the zero time and the length of the CPU was given in the milliseconds. So there are three processes in the system, so P1, P2 and P3, along with their burst time that are 24, 3 and 3 milliseconds. So and the time quantum size in this case is 4 milliseconds. So every process is given 4 milliseconds execution time, and after the time quantum expires, the process will be preempted and the CPU will select the next process in the ready. So total burst time of P1 is 24 milliseconds. The CPU will select the first process in the ready queue, that is P1. It will start the execution, it will start at the 0th time and it will finish at the 4 milliseconds. When the time quantum expires, the CPU will be given to the next process in the ready queue, that is P2. And the total time, burst time of P2 is 3 milliseconds, that is less than the one time quantum. So it will release the CPU as soon as it will finish the execution before the time quantum expires. So it will start at the 4 milliseconds and it will finish at the 7 milliseconds. At 7 milliseconds, the P3 will start the execution and it will finish at 10 milliseconds. So now the P2 and P3 has been executed. The remaining process P1 will execute in chunks of 4 millisecond time quantum. The total turnaround time of from the Gantt chart, we can see the total turnaround time of P1 is 30 milliseconds, total turnaround time of P2 is 7 milliseconds, and turnaround time of P3 is 10 milliseconds. To calculate the waiting time, in this case, the waiting time of P1 is 0. P1 is preempted at 4 milliseconds and again it is started at 10 milliseconds. So the waiting time is 10 minus 4, 6 milliseconds. Similarly, P2 has started at 4 milliseconds because the total burst time of P2 is 3 milliseconds, it will finish at 7 milliseconds. So P2 have to wait till the P1 executes. So the waiting time of P2 is 4 milliseconds. Similarly, we can calculate the waiting time of P3. This is another example of round robin CPU scheduling algorithm with the time quantum 20 milliseconds. We have a set of processes P1, P2, P3, and P4 along with the burst time. We can make the Gantt chart to simulate this problem. P1 starts at the 0 milliseconds because the time quantum length is 20 milliseconds. So at 20 milliseconds it will be preemptive and P2 will get the CPU. The total burst time of P2 is 70 milliseconds, that's less than the time quantum. So it will start at 20 milliseconds and it will finish at 37 milliseconds. As soon as P2 will finish the execution, P3 will start. The total burst time of P3 is 68 milliseconds. It will be executed for 20 milliseconds and remaining it will be preempted, and the remaining 48 milliseconds will be executed later. This is the same for the P4. So total burst time is 24 milliseconds. The time quantum is 20 milliseconds. So it will execute for 20 milliseconds, and then it will be preempted. As soon as a process is preempted, it is added at the tail of the ready queue. So we will not add in case of round robin CPU shedding algorithm, the ready queue is treated as circular list. So again, after all the process has been executed, P1 will get the execution. The remaining time of P1 is 53 minus 20, that is 43 milliseconds. So again, it will start the execution. It will start at the 77 milliseconds and it will get 20 milliseconds time quantum. So the 97th it will again preempt it, and so on. In this way, we will execute all the process. Using this diagram, we can show the relation between the time quantum and context switch. For example, the total burst time of a process is 10 milliseconds and the time quantum is 12 milliseconds. It means the time quantum length is larger than the process burst time. So, as soon as the process will get the CPU, it will execute before the time quantum expires. The number of context switches is very zero in this case. But if we decrease the time quantum, say 6 milliseconds, and the process burst time is 10 milliseconds, we will have one context switch. And again, we decrease the time quantum, say the time quantum length is 1 milliseconds, it will execute, total number of context switches will be 9. So, we want the time quantum to be larger with respect to the context switch time. The context switch time is approximately 10% of the time quantum, and then about 10% of the CPU time will be spent in the context switching. In that case, most modern systems have a time quantum ranging from 10 to 100 milliseconds. The time required for context switching is typically less than 10 milliseconds, thus the context switch time is small fraction of the time quantum process. The next category of CPU shedding algorithm is multi-level queue CPU shedding algorithm. Generally, this algorithm is used when the process can be classified in different groups. Since the different set of process requires different response time from the CPU, one of the classification may be like we can divide the total number of process in the system some process can be kept in the program process list and another can be kept in the breakdown process list. We know that program processes are interactive processes and they need more CPU response time compared to the breakdown process. At the same time, each queue, program queue and breakdown queue, has its own scheduling algorithm. Like the program can be can use round robin because it needs more response, and the breakdown can use FCFS because it needs less response from the CPU. The restriction associated with the multi-level queue CPU shedding algorithm is the process is permanently assigned to a particular queue. The process cannot move from one queue to another queue during the operation. This is the example. Suppose total number of processes in the system are divided in various queues, and every queue having a priority. If a queue having the highest priority having some process the queue with the lowest priority will not get the CPU. So if there is, using this diagram, we can say if there is any process in the queue with the highest priority, the queue with the lowest priority will not get executed. So first, the CPU will be allocated to all the processes in the highest priority queue, and if there is no process in the queue with the highest priority, then the CPU will switch from the highest priority queue to lowest priority queue, and so on. But the restriction associated with this CPU shedding algorithm is process cannot move from one queue to another. A process, the next category, next type of CPU shedding algorithm is multi-level feedback queue. In this case, the process can move between the various queues, and edge can be implemented by some way. The idea is to separate process according to characteristics of CPU burst time. The process uses too much CPU time, it will be moved to the lower priority queue. This scheme leaves IO bound and the effective process in the higher priority queues. The process that waits too long in the lower priority queue may be moved to the higher priority queue to implement the aging concept. So the multi-level feedback queue scheduler defined by following parameters. We have number of queues, and every queue having predefined CPU time quantum. Scheduling algorithm, and there is a scheduling algorithm for every queue. At the same time, we must provide a method that is used to determine when to upgrade the process and when to degrade the process. Method used to determine which queue a process will enter and when the process needs the service. By implementing these parameters, we can make the multi-level feedback queue algorithm. For example, suppose there are three queues ranging from Q1, Q2, and Q3 with a different time quantum. For Q0, the time quantum is 8 milliseconds. For Q1, the time quantum is 16 milliseconds, and for Q3, we have the larger time quantum, so it will be treated as a first come first serve scheduling algorithm. Initially, the process enter in the ready queue and put in the queue 0. A process in the Q0 is given a time quantum of 8 milliseconds, and if it does not finish its execution within the given time quantum 8 milliseconds, it will be moved to the tail of the Q1. When a process moves from Q0 to Q1, it will get another 16 milliseconds time quantum to finish its execution. If the Q0 is empty, the process at the head of the Q1 is given the time quantum of 16 milliseconds, and it does not complete its execution in the given time quantum 16 milliseconds, it is preempted and put in the Q2. Processes in the Q2 are run using the FCFS CPU shedding algorithm, and we assume that they will finish their execution because the FCFS is a non-KPU CPU shedding algorithm, and each process is acquire the CPU and it will use the CPU till it finishes its execution. Using this diagram, we can see initially the process is entered at the Q0 with a time quantum 8. If it executes totally, it will release this, it will release the CPU, and if it is not able to finish the execution with the given time quantum 8 milliseconds, it will be entered, the process will enter at the tail of the Q1 that has the time quantum 16. And so on. So let us conclude the discussion. We started our discussion with the introduction of priority CPU shedding algorithm. We discussed various example of parent distribution in algorithm. There are two types of parent distribution in algorithm, that is preemptive and non-preemptive. Then we discuss the Kamloff distribution in algorithm, we also discuss the performance parameter of the round robin distribution in algorithm. Later we discuss the multi-level queue CP shuttling algorithm, and we ended our discussion with the multi-level feedback queue CP shuttling algorithm. Thank you.